it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
Amen.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. And the reading today comes from Deuteronomy chapter 4, picking it up at verses 10. Especially the day that thou stoodest before the Lord thy God in Horeb, when the Lord said unto me, gather me the people together, and I will make them hear my words, that they may learn to fear me all the days that they shall live upon the earth, and that they may teach their children. And ye came near and stood under the mountain, and the mountain burned with fire under the midst of heaven, with darkness, clouds, and thick darkness. And the Lord spake unto you out of the midst of the fire. Ye heard the voice of the words, but saw no similitude, only ye heard a voice. And he declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments, and he wrote them upon 2 tables of stone. And the Lord commanded me at that time to teach you statutes and judgments, that ye might do them in the land whether ye go and possess it. Teach ye therefore good, take ye therefore good heed unto yourselves, for ye saw no manner of similitude on the day that the Lord spake unto you in Horeb out of the midst of the fire. I have read for you Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 10 through 15. May the reading of the word of the Lord add a blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, choir. Happy Sabbath. All right.
What if God?
Let's go. 1, 2, 3.
What if God is unhappy with our praise? What if he is not pleased with the words we say? What if he takes away his love and his spirit from above? What if God is unhappy
Happy Sabbath, everyone. This is for all the commandment keepers. Let's pray and let's do it. Put your hands together. Come on. Put your hands together. Put your hands together. Come on. Come on. Come on.
I know that you think you can't pray after that mistake. And I know it's the only way you can make it better. And I know situations get too much for you to take.
And you feel like you gon' break.
And it makes you say, I can't take it.
When things get better,
so frustrated, but it's gonna be okay, cause
God's so in your corner,
gonna be there for you. Just fall on your knees, say your prayer and receive. When the world feels like it's on your shoulders,
I pray, we pray.
And your life feels like it's upside down,
I pray, we pray.
And your lonely nights are getting colder,
I pray, you
you've gone too far and you waited too late.
But I know that he loves you and there's no love greater.
And I know that you're hurting and you want your pain to end.
And you feel like you can't win.
And it makes you say, woo, I can't take it.
Woo, when will things get better?
Woo, I'm so frustrated.
But it's gonna be okay.
Gonna be okay. You got
someone in your corner.
Woo, gonna be there for you.
Just fall on your knees, say a prayer and receive.
When the world feels like it's on your shoulder,
I pray, you pray, we pray.
And your life feels like it's upside down,
I pray, you pray, we pray.
And your lonely nights are getting colder,
I pray, you pray, we pray.
I pray, you pray. No matter how dark the day,
praise the Lord for those selections from the choir. Give another hand clap. Praise the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And peace to everybody that's here in the name of Jesus. Peace to all those that are viewing on the internet. And peace to those that are listening on the telephone lines. Happy Sabbath to you. I got to pause for a second. I'm getting old, forgot my glasses. Can't read without them. At one time that wasn't the case, but it's starting to tell on me. All right, here we go. Praise the Lord for the Sabbath. Today's lesson we're going to be dealing with, the Lord gave us a plan to save ourselves. The Lord gave us a plan to save ourselves. I had went to a funeral a couple weeks ago. It was at the same church that I came from 17 years ago. And at the end of the service, you know, the preacher, he told everybody to bow their head, raise their hand if they thought that they were going to die today, and if they didn't know if they were going to be saved when they died, to raise their hand. A few people raised their hand, and then he told them to say a few prayers, say a simple prayer, and that was going to be it. They were saved. I was boiling in that seat. I was upset because it's the same thing that I had. It was the same spiel from 17 years ago. Nothing changed. Nothing at all. You know, if that were the case, that you could be saved just by saying a simple prayer, it would say that Noah, that the Lord lied to Noah, that the Lord gave Noah something he didn't need to do to save himself. All Noah had to do was just pray, Lord, save me, stand there, and the water would have passed him by. But that wasn't the case. The Lord gave Noah a plan to save himself, and 100 years, and during that 100 years, because Noah was 500 years old, and the book talk about, and we're going to read it, how in the 600th year of Noah's life, the Lord flooded the earth. So the Lord gave Noah a plan, and Noah had to implement that plan in that 600, during that time of that 600, before that 600 year got here. The Lord gives us a plan to save ourselves. We don't teach that a person is saved cut and dry, because that is not the case, and the Bible does not teach that a man is saved cut and dry. And we're gonna read a lot of examples of how that the Lord gave that same plan. See, because the Lord is holy. He's complete. He don't have to change anything. The same thing he did before, he could do it all over again, all the time. Because when the Lord implements a plan, it always works. And it always goes the same way. That's why we know, if you want to know what the Lord is going to do in the future, you find out what he's done in the past. And that's how you save yourself. The Lord gave us a plan to save ourselves. You know, before we start the lesson, I wrote this down in Amos chapter 5. Amos chapter 5, because even for us, you know, even for us, we want to be saved when the Lord returns. When the Lord returns, we know it's going to be a terrible thing that's going on. It's going to be a terrible time. And the Lord, we even have something to work out. The book even says, if the righteous scarcely be saved, what about the wicked? They're not going to make it. You know, so we should be on pins and needles all the time, because we trying to be saved. Every day is another step either closer to the grave or when the Lord returns. So we always got to stay on our P's and Q's, and it's not going to be a beautiful thing when the Lord returns. It's going to be beautiful afterwards, but when the Lord returns, it's going to be terrible. And the book speaks of that. So we got to be careful. Amos chapter 5, and we're going to pick it up at verse 18. Amos 5 and verse 18, you're going to read 18 through 20. Go ahead.
Woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. To what end is it for you? The day of the Lord is darkness and not light.
You see what he said? He said, woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. When people say, oh, I can't wait for the Lord to return. Oh, I can't wait. But the book says, woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. It's not going to be nothing nice. It's going to be something that we know it's going to happen, but as a whole, I mean, you could know something's is going to happen, and when it exceeds your expectations, you're blown away. The sky is going to roll back, and there's going to be a being sitting there waiting to come down here and tear up everything, and time is going to end as we know it. It's going to change everything. Even the elements are going to be on fire, and we're going to read that in the lesson. So he said, woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. To what end is it for you? The day of the Lord is darkness and not light. Go ahead.
As if a man did flee from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand on the wall and a serpent bit him.
So it's like you were running from, you thought you got away from one danger, and it's going to be something that's going to be even worse on the other end, because it's going to be destruction all over the place going on. Go ahead.
Shall not the day of the Lord be darkness and not light?
Uh-huh.
Even very dark and not brightness in it.
It ain't going to be no brightness in it. The Lord is going to come and destroy this earth. Tear it up, say he gonna gut it like a man gutting a building, and he gonna start from scratch again. A lot of people are gonna die. So, and the Lord, he gives us a plan. He wants us to implement so that way we can save ourselves from that destruction that he's gonna bring. And that plan that he wants us to implement, every day we're implementing it. Just like Noah had to implement that plan on building that ark. Noah couldn't just talk about building the ark. Noah had to do some work. He had to build that ark to save his life. That's what he had to do. But we're going to read about it. Genesis chapter 6. The Lord gave us a plan to save ourselves. The Lord gave us the plan to save ourselves. We don't preach again. We don't preach that a man is saved cut and dry. We are responsible for our own salvation. When that man stood there in that pulpit and he told them to raise their hands, he tricked them all. He fooled them all, because they are waiting for some false salvation that they received. They waiting for it to go to heaven, that same spiel. You know, but the Lord is going to come and they're not going to be prepared for that. Genesis chapter 6, and pick it up at verse 5 and read. Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5. Go ahead.
And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually.
Uh-huh.
And he repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart.
Sounds like a little bit of what we're looking at today. You know, you look around, it's foolish for people to believe that this world is going to continue as it is. It's foolish. This whole world it's getting wickeder and wickeder every day. That's how we know the Lord is on the verge of coming back. He said, and God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Everything that man is thinking of now is evil. All these evil inventions that are happening. Another way to scheme somebody out of some money. Another way to steal something. Another way to fornicate. It's always something more and more evil and wickeder. Go ahead.
Verse 7, and the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth,
uh-huh,
both man and beast,
uh-huh,
and the creepy thing, and the fowls of the air, for he repented me that I have made them.
So the verdict has come up. The Lord is going to kill everybody. He said he's going to destroy man and the beast and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, because the Lord, he said, for it repenteth me that I have made them. Verse 8.
But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord.
Go ahead. Verse 12. Uh-huh.
And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth.
So now Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Now Noah has grace. So now, go ahead. Verse 13.
And God said unto Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them.
Uh-huh.
And behold, I will destroy them with the earth.
Go ahead.
Make thee an ark of gopher wood.
Here comes the plan. The Lord told Noah, and pay attention, because the Lord it's always a pattern here. The Lord told Noah he was going to destroy the earth. Now the Lord gives him the plan to save himself. He gives the plan to save himself. He said, make thee an ark of gopher wood. Go ahead.
Room shalt thou make in the ark, and uh-huh, shalt pitch it within and without with pitch.
Go ahead.
And this, verse 17.
Go ahead. Verse 17.
And behold, I do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, wherein is the breath of life,
uh-huh,
from under heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die.
So now the Lord gave Noah a plan, and then he speaks again about destroying the earth. It's destroying the earth again. He's going to flood the earth. Go ahead.
Verse 18. But with thee will I establish my covenant, and thou shalt come into the ark, thou and thy sons and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee.
So now the Lord told Noah what he was going to do. And the Lord told Noah, hey, implement this plan I gave you. Build the ark. Do what you need to do. Build this ark, and you're going to save yourself and your family. What if Noah, after the Lord told Noah what to do, what if Noah said, okay, you know, the Lord's going to flood the earth. Now he prays a prayer. Lord, please don't let it happen to us, me and my family. You know, pray, Lord, please. And didn't do nothing. Noah would have died with everybody else because he didn't follow the plan of salvation that the Lord gave him. Let's look at Genesis chapter 7 now.
Verse 22.
I'm sorry, go ahead. Verse 22. Go ahead.
Thus did Noah according to all that God commanded him. So did he.
So did he. So now he implemented the plan. Genesis chapter 7 now. Genesis 7, and we're going to pick it up at verse 11. Genesis 7 and 11. Go ahead.
In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened.
So now in the 600th year, so now Noah had almost like something like 100 years to implement the Lord's plan that he had made. Because the Lord wasn't going to change him destroying the earth because Noah didn't do his job. The Lord had a plan that the Lord had his mind set up, and the only way that you had to save yourself, the only way Noah would save himself is by implementing the plan that God had gave him. So it says in verse 11, he says, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, on the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were open. So now the destruction comes. Verse 12.
And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights.
Go ahead. Skip down to verse 21 and read.
And all the flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl and of cattle and of beasts and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. And every man, all in whose nostrils was the breath of life, of all that was in the dry land died. And every living substance was destroyed, which was upon the face of the ground. Both man and cattle and the creeping things and the fowl of the heaven. And they were destroyed from the earth. And Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark.
So now if Noah wouldn't have did what the Lord told him to do, Noah would have died with all the rest of them. The Lord gave Noah the plan to save himself. It was up to Noah to implement that plan. Just like with us, the Lord has given us a plan, and we're going to read it later. The Lord has given us a plan to save ourselves. And it's up to us if we implement it or not, because the Lord is not going to change his mind. See, but only this time when the Lord comes back, it's going to be with fire. It's going to be with fire. So we have to prepare ourselves. It's good that we've come here and we're sitting here and we learn about the scripture. But then when we go back outside them doors, we got to implement that plan every day.
That's right.
Every day. And it never stops. From the time you get up on your feet to the time you get back into bed, even while you're sleeping, you got to watch your dreams sometimes if you can. You know, you got to do the best you can, because the Lord is not going to, he's not going to go back on what he said. Let's look at another example. Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. Because again, when you want to know what the Lord is going to do, he always leaves a footprint or a fingerprint. He lets you know what his plan is, because he don't want to kill everybody, but he will. It's up to us not to be with everybody else. We got to sanctify ourselves by keeping his word, keeping his laws and his statutes. Exodus chapter 12, and we're going to read verse 1. Exodus 12 and verse 1. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you.
See, this is how we know that the new year, and we're going to learn something on the way to learn this, going somewhere. Praise so we know that the new year begins in the spring. Because this is about the springtime, this has happened. And we just celebrated the Passover not too long ago. So now he said, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Go ahead.
Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their father, a lamb for an house.
Uh-huh.
And if that household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your account for the lamb.
So now that's not just a good dinner that the Lord is preparing. He's preparing them to, again, save themselves. So go ahead.
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening.
Go ahead.
And they shall take of the blood and strike it on two side posts and on the upper door posts of the house wherein they shall eat it.
So now the Lord, he's not, again, he don't do anything in vain. The Lord has Israel putting blood over the doorposts. And this is good for even us today, because the only way that we're going to be able to save ourselves is by coming up under this blood, the blood of Jesus. That's how we're going to be able to save ourselves. Go ahead.
Verse 13. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
Uh-huh.
And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you.
Uh-huh.
When I smite the land of Egypt.
So now he gave them a plan. He said, look, I'm going to come in there. I'm going to pass through. Verse 12, he said, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. And I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. He said all the firstborn. So what if Israel didn't put no blood over their doorposts? He'd have killed their firstborn too.
That's right.
It was up to them to implement the plan that the Lord had gave them. He said, I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. So now he gave them the ultimatum. He told them the verdict. Hey, I'm coming through. Prepare yourselves. Go ahead. Verse
21.
Go ahead.
Then Moses called for the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and strike the lintel and two side posts with the blood that is in the basin.
Uh-huh.
And none of you shall go out at the door of the house until the morning.
Go ahead.
For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he see the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your house to smite you.
So now it was up to them to implement the plan. The Lord gave Moses the plan. Moses shared it with the rest of the people. The people had to go out and they had to do what the Lord told them to do. But like you have nowadays, you have people that you could think that they could serve God any kind of way they want to do it. You know, the Lord went through all these directions to show Israel how to save themselves. He went through all those directions and told Noah exactly how to build the ark. He told him exactly how to build the ark. And Noah had to go by them directions that the Lord gave him. But nowadays, all you got to do is say a simple prayer and you good. That's a lie. You have to do the work. You got to put the work in. You can't just pray a prayer and expect the Lord to do everything else for you. That's not how it works at all. It's not how it works at all. If you don't do your part, hey, the Lord's still going to do what he said he's going to do. You're just going to be a part of the destruction. You're going to be part of the fuel of the fire, basically. You have a job to do. We all have a job to do. That's why I'm scared all the time. Because, hey, I know the Lord, he's not going to turn back from what he said. He's going to kill a lot of people. He's going to kill a lot of people. I don't want to be one of them people he's going to kill. So now they had in read verse 23 again.
For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you.
Now skip down to verse 28 and read.
And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So did they.
They start praying.
No.
No. They did the work. They put in the work. Same way Noah had to put in the work. Same way. Well, the Lord told us, and we're going to read it later, but it said, Jesus said, if you will enter into life, keep the commandments.
Right.
And we know about the Ten Commandments, but then when you keep the Ten Commandments, it also has other commands the Lord gave us too. You know, even the holy days, those are commandments. And guess what? In those commandments, in those holy days, he shows us his plan of salvation. And we're going to see it later. But where you at?
Verse 29.
Go ahead.
And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt.
Uh-huh.
From the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle.
Mm-hmm.
And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead.
So he came and he did exactly what he said he was going to do. So again, if you were doing this time and you didn't put the blood over your doorpost, just think about your firstborn child. Your firstborn child would have lost their life.
That's right.
Why? Because you didn't do what the Lord told you to do. You could have saved your house, but you didn't do what the Lord told you to do. That's why it's important that we remember all the time that, hey, our salvation is in our own hands. Like the book say, let every man work out his own salvation with what? Fear and trembling. You should be scared. Because when the Lord returns, it's not going to be nothing pretty. It's going to be terrible. We can be lulled to sleep like them people at that church that I went to that had it like they were lulled to sleep. Bad thing, and they could just say a few simple words and the Lord was going to save them. And that was going to be it. I couldn't believe that. I couldn't believe it. It's the same spiel from way back when I was going there. You know, then you have these Muslim brothers. You know, they don't believe in none of this. And it's a lot of them. They don't believe in none of this. But yet they expect that when the Lord comes and when the Lord sets his kingdom up on this earth, hey, you ain't going, it ain't like you're going to go farm some land somewhere before the Lord comes and you're going to be able to save yourself. The Lord's going to come, and wherever you are, you're going to know that the Lord is returning. He don't care about no community set up that we done went and invested some money in or whatever. You can invest until you blue in the face. You can invest, but guess what? At the end of the day, the Lord is going to tear this earth up, and all your investments are going to go with it. Hmm. All your investments. It doesn't matter where you are, and you can build. We done had our own communities today, and I'm talking about those brothers that go out and say, well, you know, we need to build some. We need to go and get some money, and we need to separate ourselves and have our own community set up. You know, we had that before. We had all these things before. You know, what is that? Tulsa in Oklahoma, what is that? Black Wall Street and all these other communities, Rosewood, all these other famous communities and some that they don't even speak about. Those things happened before. And guess what? They were torn up. They were torn up. So because the Lord wants you to know your hope ain't in investments. Your hope is in what he told you to do. That's where your hope is. That's where your hope is. Where we at, bro?
At the end of it.
Go ahead.
That was the end of it.
Okay. Well, let's pick it up at
14.
Exodus 14. Exodus chapter 14. The Lord gave us the plan to save ourselves, and it is up to us to implement the plan to save ourselves. Exodus 14 and pick it up at verse 1 and read. Exodus 14 and verse 1. Because now the Lord went past through Egypt. He didn't kill the firstborn, but the Lord is not finished. Because when you follow the Lord's plan, he's like thousands of years. He's thousands of steps ahead of us, way, way ahead of us. So now he's not only finished killing the firstborn, he got some other work to do. Exodus 14 and pick it up at verse 1 and read.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, that they turn and encamp before Phil-Hithro, between Migdal and the sea, over against Baal-Zephon, before it shall ye encamp by the sea.
So the Lord led them right to the Red Sea. He led them right to the Red Sea. Because again, the Lord, he's implementing his plan. All they got to do is follow it, and the Lord is going to do the rest. He's going to do the rest. Verse 3.
But Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land. The wilderness has shut them in.
Go ahead.
And I will harden Pharaoh's heart that he shall follow after them. And I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his hosts that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord, and they did so.
So the Lord is getting ready to kill Pharaoh's army and Pharaoh as well. So now he's going to lead him all the way to that. He's going to lead him all the way there. Now he's going to harden Pharaoh's heart. Because again, the Lord is in control of all spirits. He's a God of all spirits. He's going to leave Pharaoh there. Go ahead.
And it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and his heart and the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this, that we have let Israel go from serving us?
So now the thought comes in their mind after they let him go, like, why we do this? You know, that's why we even got to examine ourselves, even based on scripture like this. When you have that second thought, the Lord told you to do one thing, and then all of a sudden you get that second thought in your head. That could be the thought that's going to probably knock you off. You know, you don't know. You could be setting yourself up for destruction. So again, we got to pray to the Lord and ask the Lord to guide our feet. So he said in verse 5, he said, it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this? Why we let them go, man? We ain't got nobody to pick our cotton or whatever they did, build no bricks. You know, I got the guard and I wanted that slave to dig, and he gone now. Now I got to dig it myself. You know, so now go ahead, verse 8.
And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued after the children of Israel.
Uh-huh.
And the children of Israel went out with a high hand, but the Egyptians pursued after them all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh and his horsemen and his army, and overtook them encamping by the sea beside
Hithroth.
Before Baal Zephon.
Right.
And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them.
So this was supposed to be an aha moment for Pharaoh. I got y'all now. But no, Pharaoh set himself up for destruction. Go ahead.
And they were sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there was no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is it not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness.
Now, they feel like getting ready to die, and they still got time to complain. They should be running that water, trying to get away, doing something. It should be masking, but they got time to argue with Moses. And Moses has to keep his composure because, again, the Lord gave him a plan to save himself already. Moses just has to implement it. He can't let the people get him sidetracked. And he is, go ahead, he gonna implement it, verse 13.
And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord.
Go ahead.
Which he will show to you today. For the Egyptian whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again, no more forever.
Uh-huh.
The Lord shall fight for you.
The Lord shall fight for your peace. And you shall hold your peace. The Lord's going to fight for you. Shut up. Because the Lord got this. He got this plan. All he had to do is go and implement the plan. Stay with the plan. Don't get sidetracked. Stay with the plan. Skip down to verse 24 and
you don't want to read 15.
Yeah, read 15. I'm sorry.
And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea.
Pray your way through it, Moses. Pray your way through it. No. He said, but lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thy hand over the sea and divide it. Moses had some work to do. Mixed with faith, he had to lift up his rod and do what the Lord told him to do. And divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on the dry ground through the midst of the sea. They're supposed to see what the Lord was doing with Moses, and that was supposed to strengthen their faith. But go ahead.
And behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them, and will get me honor upon Pharaoh.
He said, I'm going to give me honor upon Pharaoh. He's going to kill Pharaoh. He's going to kill Pharaoh. Go ahead.
And upon all his hosts.
And upon his all chariots. His hosts and his chariots. Go
and
ahead.
And upon his horsemen.
All his horsemen. Now, when go ahead. Just keep
and
reading.
The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. Mm-hmm. When I have gotten me honor upon Pharaoh, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen.
He said upon his horsemen too. Go ahead. Skip down to verse 24 and read.
And it came to pass that in the morning watch, that the Lord looked unto the host of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and of the cloud, and troubled the host of the Egyptians.
So now they rushing through the Red Sea. I always ask myself, Pharaoh had to be really ticked off for his mind. Now, the Lord had did all these things when he was in Egypt. He didn't kill the firstborn. He didn't, you know, made it dark on one side, light on the other. He did all these miracles in Egypt. And now the Lord split the Red Sea. Why did Pharaoh run in that water? Why did he do that? He ran right in that water. But again, you can get so angry, you ain't even thinking. And that's what the Lord had made happen to Pharaoh here. So he said, in the verse 24, he said, and it came to pass that in the morning watch, the Lord looked unto the host of the Egyptians through the pillar of fire and of the clouds, and troubled the host of the Egyptians. Go ahead.
And took off their chariot wheels, that they drave them heavily, so that the Egyptians said, let us flee from the face of Israel, for the Lord fighteth for them against the Egyptians.
It was too late by then because they were in the water. They were already in there, and the Lord had them exactly where he wanted them. Go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand over the sea, that the waters may come again upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horses.
Uh-huh.
And Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea.
He implemented the plan that the Lord gave him. He did what the Lord told him to do, the simplicity of Christ. He did what he was told. Go ahead.
And the sea returned to its strength when the morning appeared,
uh-huh.
And the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea.
Go ahead.
And the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen and all the host of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. There remained not so much as one of them.
He killed them all. He killed them all. Why? Because he implemented the plan that the Lord gave them. So they ain't have to worry about them no more. The Lord gave Moses and the children of Israel, our forefathers, the plan to save themselves, and they did it, and they saved themselves. Go ahead, keep
reading. Verse 30. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the shore.
So he said, thus the Lord saved Israel that day. Because again, that goes, that you can't say that you were saved now and forever. He said that day. They still had more work that they had to do. They still had more work that they had to do. Let's go to Numbers now. Numbers 21. They were saved from Pharaoh. The Lord gave them a plan to be saved from Pharaoh that day. But then life goes on. The Lord gives us the plan to save ourselves each day. But life still continues. We still continue. Life still goes on with us. And we got to continue to follow that plan, the plan of salvation. Let's look at another example. Numbers 21. So now we're going to look at get another example, because they started murmuring with Moses while they was at the Red Sea. Now they started, this is going to happen. Numbers 21, pick up verse 1. Go ahead.
And when King Arad, the Canaanite, which dwelt in the south, heard tell that Israel came by the way of the spies, then he fought against Israel and took some of them prisoner.
Go ahead.
And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou wilt indeed deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities.
Go ahead.
And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he called the name of the place Hormiah.
So now the Lord had worked it out. He didn't allow them to overcome an army, allowed them to overcome some Canaanites here. Israel vowed a vow, and the Lord had heard it, and the Lord delivered the Canaanites into their hand. Verse 4.
And they journeyed from the Mount Hur by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom.
Go ahead.
And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way.
Now they ticked out now. They ticked off now because they discouraged now. Earlier, it talks about how Moses, how they made Moses so mad, they got him in trouble. You know, and they still talking. And now the Lord, he's getting angry with them. So now go ahead, verse 5.
And the people spake against God and against Moses, wherefore have ye brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness.
Go ahead.
For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loathe this light bread.
Now, they mocking the bread that the Lord gave them. The Lord is feeding them, and they mocking that. So now the Lord is going to do something. Verse 6.
And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died.
Now they all died. The Lord sent them serpents, and now they died. While they were murmuring and mad and all this other stuff, while the Lord's feeding them, they got angry, start talking crazy, and the Lord allowed something to happen to them. And a lot of Israelites died. But now the Lord is going, he's going to even save a lot of them from dying too. Some of them died, a lot of them died, but now verse 7.
Therefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us.
Uh-huh.
And Moses prayed for the people.
Verse 8.
And the people said unto Moses, make thee a fire. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole. And shall come to pass that everyone that is bidden, when he looketh upon it, shall live.
The plan of salvation again. Another plan. The snake started biting people. The people that were bit, all they had to do was what the Lord told Moses to do. All they had to do was look at the serpent that Moses had made on the brass. He said in verse 8, he said, the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bidden, when he looketh upon it, he shall live. He didn't tell them to pray their way out of it. He didn't. He told them to do something. Verse 9.
And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived.
He lived. And this even points to Jesus down the road, because Jesus is going to mention this later on in his lesson. But they had to go to the serpent, and they had to look at the serpent on a pole. And it was just the fact that their faith saved them. But they still had to have the works. They had to go to the serpent and look at it. And when they looked at the serpent, on the brass pole, they were healed. The Lord gave them the plan of salvation. It was up to them to make sure that they did it. They had to follow it. 1 Corinthians 10. They had to follow the plan of salvation. The world is heading for a terrible time. And we trying to warn people all the time. We get mocked. We was getting mocked by some Muslims, you know. But guess what? The plan that they have is to build something, separate yourself, and live over here. The Lord is going to come, and he's going to take this whole world over. He don't care about no little patch of land. And then how you going to separate yourselves in your enemy's land anyway? You can't do it. But yet, again, that's that drunk theory. And then they talk about the spook God and all this other stuff. That's some crazy stuff. We know that there is a God there. And he is the God of all creation. And he told us to end from the beginning. That's why we know this plan of salvation is going to work, because we have proof that it works. We've seen it. We can read it, and we are walking proof today that the God of Israel does live, because he cursed us. We are a walking example of a God that lives. We are a walking example of a living God who sits on the right hand of the Father, waiting for his enemies to be made his footstool so he can come and redeem his people. Well, that's what we are. We are a walking example of that. We are cursed. We are in trouble, waiting for the Lord to redeem us. 1 Corinthians 10, and pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead.
Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers was under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Uh-huh.
For they drank of the spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ.
So this lets us know again, Jesus was way in the Old Testament. That was him that was speaking to Moses. That was him that told him to raise that serpent up. That was him that told him to part the Red Sea. That was Jesus that was there. He said they all drink of that spiritual, and verse 4, he said, and all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Go ahead, verse 5.
But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness.
Uh-huh.
Now, these things was our example.
Now, they are examples, because we saw what would happen if when they complained. The Lord killed a whole lot of them. You know, we saw the example of, hey, when they were in Egypt and the Lord told them to put the blood over their doorposts, what would have happened if they had not did that? And they got all the way out there in the wilderness and they started complaining and the Lord killed a whole lot of them again. He was killing them left and right. They are our examples of what not to do. Go ahead.
To the intent we should not lust after evil things.
Go ahead.
As they also lusted. Neither be ye idolaters, as were some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play.
Go ahead.
Neither let us commit fornications, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000.
The Lord's killed them left and right. Go ahead.
Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed of serpents.
How did they tempt them? By murmuring against them. They murmured against him. He let the serpents bite them, and then he gave them a plan. Hey, I'm not going to all the rest of y'all. Look, all you got to do is, you know, look at this serpent right here. He gave them the plan to save themselves. Go ahead.
Neither murmur ye as some of them also murmured and was destroyed and were destroyed of the destroyer.
So now those are our examples. Those are examples. So we have examples all through the book. We just read a lot of examples of how the Lord saved Noah. Noah did the work. The Lord gave him the plan to save himself. Noah implemented the plan. Noah saved his whole house. The Lord gave the Passover. Israel implemented the plan, put the blood over the doorpost. They saved themselves from the destroyer. So the Lord gave the plan of salvation, and he never changes. He gives us a plan of salvation. All we have to do is implement the plan every day. Give us this day our daily bread. You know, keep keeping the Lord's commandments. Don't get sidetracked. You know, don't let nobody talk you out of it. Don't let nobody try to knock you off your square, because the square that you own is the true square. You stay and keep God's commandments, and you continue, and you are going to save yourself from this untoward generation. Let's look at, let's look at Isaiah 24. Isaiah 24. And we're going to read verse 4 and 6. Isaiah 24 and verse 4 through 6. Because the Lord, just like he told Noah, the Lord is going to warn us. He's warning us. Verse 24 and verse 4. Go ahead.
The earth mourneth and fadeth away. The world languisheth and fadeth away. The halted people of the earth do languish.
Go ahead.
The earth also is defiled under the inhabitants thereof.
Everything is messed up now, y'all. Everything. You know, the ground is poison. The water is poison. You don't know if your cup of water got lead in it. You know, everything is messed up. We are dying more and more and more. But everybody else is saying, like, you know, we gonna make it better. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. We're going to do all these things to make it better. It's only going to get worse. It's only going to get worse. So it says, the earth is defiled under the inhabitants thereof. Go ahead.
Because they have transgressed the laws,
uh-huh,
changed the ordinances, broke the everlasting covenant.
Broken the everlasting covenant. That's why everything is so messed up. And it's not going to get no better. And we know it's not going to get better. What should we be doing? We should be saving ourselves, getting the plan of salvation in our mind so that we can continue and we can save ourselves, because the Lord is going to do exactly what he said he's going to do. Verse 6.
Therefore hath the curse devoured the earth, and they that dwell therein are desolate.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore the inhabitants of the earth are burned, and few men left.
Because when the Lord returns, again, this is a message to us in the future. The Lord is going to come, and this time he's coming back with fire. It's not going to be there's not going to be water. He's going to burn the whole earth. How do we save ourselves from this? How do we save ourselves? By following the Lord's plan of salvation that he laid out. Zephaniah now. Zephaniah chapter 2. Zephaniah chapter 2. And pick it up at verse 3. Zephaniah 2 and verse 3. Go ahead.
Seek ye the Lord, all ye meek of the earth.
Seek the Lord, all ye meek of the earth. Go ahead.
Which have wrought his judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Seek the righteousness. Seek the meekness. It may be ye shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger.
Because we trying to be hid from that anger that's coming. And how do we be hid from that anger that's coming? Because the Lord has warned us now so that we can be hid from this anger. Because when he comes, he's going to burn up everything. He's going to burn up everything. Pick it up at Zephaniah 3 and 8 and 9. Go ahead.
Therefore, wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey.
He said, wait for me until I rise up. Go ahead.
For my determination is to gather the nations that I may assemble the kingdoms to pour upon them my indignation, even all my fierce anger.
See, he's warning us. He's warning us now. Same way he warned Noah. He said, everything is messed up. No, I'm gonna flood the earth. So now he's warning us again. Go ahead.
For all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy.
Let's look at Isaiah. So now he talk about bringing the fire again. He's talking about fire. We done read how the Lord in Isaiah 24, he's talking about the inhabitants are burned and few men left. He talks about how he's going to burn up the earth again. Again, the Lord's going to come in flame and fire. And how do we save ourselves from the whole world? The world is going to be that he's going to come and he's going to destroy everything. How do we save ourselves from that? Isaiah 66. Again, it's just an example of the Lord, how he's warning us. But yet, in the church, they telling us, in the Sunday church, they're telling you to just say a few words. You know, pray a few words, and you're going to be saved. You know, you're going to be saved. Then the Lord's going to rapture you to heaven. That's not good. They are lying to people left and right. And those people, when the time comes, they ain't going to know what to do. It's like you in a building, everybody is going through the fire drills, and you over here somewhere, you don't know what no exits are, whatever. You over here just kicking and talking to people like, ain't going to never happen. Ain't going to never happen. You know, because when it comes, they're going to just come and get me. The firemen's going to come and get me. They're going to save me, you know. And then the fire kick off, and everybody knows the drill. They gone. But you over there like, which way do we go? Why? Because you were not prepared. Right. You weren't prepared. You didn't follow the drill. We are following the drill now. We know that the Lord is coming. We are preparing ourselves for the Lord's return. Right. And how are we doing that? By seeking the Lord, by keeping his laws and his statutes. Isaiah 66 and verse 15, another warning. Go ahead.
For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire.
Yeah, that fire again. But you got these brothers saying that ain't going to happen. You know, they talking about, you know, we believe in a spook God. The spook God, what they think the spook God is, he going to burn up this whole earth.
That's right.
He going to burn it up. Go ahead.
For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh. And the slain of the Lord shall be many.
A couple people.
Many.
Many. Go ahead.
They that sanctify themselves and purify themselves in the gardens behind one tree in the midst, eating swine's flesh and the abomination and the mouth shall be consumed together, saith the Lord.
They all gonna die, even the ones that ain't keeping this dietary law. Again, see, those people are gonna be burned up because they're not keeping his laws. They are not following his plan of salvation. They're not following his plan so they can save themselves. Let's look at Ecclesiastes 8 now. Because you got these the same way. And again, that's how you know the Bible is true, because it talks about us right now and how we thinking. I ain't gonna say how we think, because I don't think like that. Ecclesiastes chapter 8. And pick it up at verse 11. Ecclesiastes 8 and verse 11. Go ahead.
Because sentence against the evil work is not executed speedily. Therefore, the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil.
Oh, man, they've been saying that for a long time. The Lord is going to come. The Lord is going to come. He ain't came yet. He ain't came yet. Go ahead. Verse 12.
Though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged, yet surely I know that it shall be well with them that fear God, which fear before him.
See, because it said, though a sinner do evil 100 times and his days be prolonged, he think he getting away with it. So, and that's how the whole world is. They think they're getting away with it. They think this is not going to happen. See, but that time, the Lord is on a whole nother different time and space than we are. To the Lord, this stuff, hey, 1,000 years to us is one day to the Lord. It's one day. So it just, hey, the Lord ain't, hey, it's like it just happened. Moses and all just happened. See, all that stuff had just happened. You know, all these things had just happened. Go ahead, verse 12.
13.
I'm sorry, verse 13. Go
but
ahead.
But it shall not be well with the wicked, neither shall be prolonged his days, which are as a shadow, because he feareth not before God.
See, so all these things that happened long time, like 1,000 years ago, when Moses was before that, but 1,000 years ago, that stuff just like it's just happened with the Lord. It just happened. But let's look at 2 Peter now. Second Peter chapter 3. These are things that we got to keep in mind. Second Peter chapter 3, and we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Second Peter chapter 3, and we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Because, again, you got people that are still scoffing, like those brothers we were talking to. Same, them brothers, them same Jakes has been around deceiving people. 3:1, go ahead.
This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandments of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior.
So he said that she be mindful. He's stirring up our minds are being stirred up too. That's why it's important that we come and keep the Sabbath and continue. No matter how many times you think you just heard the same lesson or whatever, it's like reading the Bible. You always learn something new.
Praise
he
the
said,
Lord.
He said, this second epistle, beloved, I write unto you, and both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. He said, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before the holy prophets. And we need to be mindful as well, because they've been telling us about the end coming. And we need to be mindful of that. He said, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Go ahead.
Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lust.
See, that's how you can tell we in the last days, because they everywhere. They are everywhere joking about, oh, y'all believing that Jesus is coming. What, he going to bust the sky open? Yeah. That's how they believe. Yeah, but we know he's going to come. It's a joke to them, and it's a lot of them out there too. It's a whole lot of them. Y'all believe in that Jesus. You know, then you got the Sunday Christians. They like, well, you know, we're going to be raptured. They scoffing too. They just don't know it. Because they look at us like, y'all, the Lord ain't going to come and do that. He going to rapture some people up off this earth. No, the Lord is going to come. He said in verse 4.
And saying, where's the promise of his coming?
He been saying that for a long time. Where's the promise of his coming? Go ahead.
For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation.
See, they think it's going to keep going on. But anybody can tell, when you look at the world today, it's terrible. And it's getting worse and worse. Anytime you have a man that want to take some pills so he can become a woman, time is terrible. You know, anytime you go into a gas station or a store and you can't tell who's the man and who's the woman, time is messed up. It's messed up out here. You know, you got kids killing their parents. You know, you got the businesses running, you know, taking money from the poor, and they say, hey, we ain't got to, we innocent, we straight. You know, the Bible even speaks about that. So we are in the last days today. They are scoffing today. He said in the last days, in verse 4, he said, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Verse 5.
For this they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of God the heavens were of old, see, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water.
He didn't call them smart, did he? He said they are willingly ignorant. You can be willingly ignorant. Willingly ignorant. The Lord, all this stuff, everything the Lord has created, the trees and the heavens and everything, when you the space and all these things the Lord created, you have to be crazy to think that some type of explosion happened and created all this stuff. They are willingly ignorant. They are willingly ignorant. When they look at us, they're taking advantage of us left and right, you know, and they're doing all these atrocities. They are willingly ignorant to believe that they're not nothing is going to happen to them. Time repeats itself. Time repeats itself, and the Lord is going to bring this thing to a screeching halt in a little while. Verse 5, he said, and for this they are willingly ignorant of, by that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the waters and in the water. Verse 6.
Whereby the world that was being overflowed with water perished.
The Lord killed everybody before. He flooded the earth before. And we read that when Noah was saved by implementing the plan of salvation the Lord had gave him. So now the Lord's talking about doing it by fire. They are willingly ignorant to think that the Lord is not going to do what he said he's going to do. But we are preparing ourselves. Go ahead.
But the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and prediction of ungodly men.
So he said... He said it's reserved until fire against the day of judgment and perdition. And, of course, we know that means destruction of ungodly men, because the Lord is going to burn this world up again. He's going to make it a quick work. He said in some place that in Isaiah, he said man is going to be like the golden wedge of Ophir. He's going to be precious. He's going to kill a whole lot of people. He killed a lot of people during the time of Noah. He killed everybody and saved 8 people. Why? Because Noah implemented the plan that the Lord had gave him. Noah implemented the plan of salvation, and the Lord saved Noah. Verse 8, go ahead.
But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise.
He going to do what he said he going to do. He not slack concerning his promises. Go ahead.
As some men count slackness, but in long suffering to us ward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
What they call slackness, we call mercy, because we trying to get ourselves in order. Sometimes stuff gets so bad, it gets so terrible, and a trial and tribulation of this life. Hey, you just like want to lay down and not get up sometimes, because it gets so bad. But you're not ready for that. The Lord is being merciful to you because you still got stuff that you need to do. Because you get yourself in order. The Lord is merciful towards us. He said, verse 9, he said, the Lord is not slack concerning his promises, because he said he's going to do what he's going to do. And as some men count slackness, but long suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. Because he don't want to kill nobody, but he's going to do it. If you don't do what you said, if you don't follow the Lord's commandments, if you don't follow his plan, you are going to die. You're going to die. And we're talking about dying twice. Go ahead.
But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved.
Now, we read about fire, burning, fire, murder, death, kill. We read about all these things. We are preparing ourselves because the Lord is going to come with fire. See, again, he's warning us. He's warning us the same way he warned Noah. He said, Noah, I'm going to flood the earth. And he gave Noah a plan. And he's going to give, we're going to read about his plan. Go ahead.
Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of person ought ye to be in all holy conversation and goodness, godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat.
He's telling us he's going to burn it up. Get ready. I'm going to burn it up. Go ahead.
Nevertheless, we according to his promise look for a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness.
Now let's look at John chapter 3. So now consider the Lord had told us, he's telling us that he's going to burn up everything. He's going to burn up the world. Now he's going to give us a plan of salvation. How do we save ourselves from being part of the burning? John chapter 3. How do we save ourselves? What is the plan that the Lord gave us to save ourselves? Just like he gave Noah. He gave Noah a plan. What's our plan since he warned us that he's going to come and burn up the earth? John chapter 3. And pick it up at verse 14. John chapter 3 and verse 14. Go ahead.
And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up.
Now, we read that. We read about Moses being lifted up, how Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. And it talks about how Jesus must be lifted up. Go ahead.
That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
This is the plan of salvation right here. This is our plan right here. Whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If those people didn't believe what the Lord told Moses to do, those people would have died. So now that we have to believe on Jesus so that we can get eternal life. But it's more than just saying that we believe. Because we know Noah, the Lord gave Noah the plan. It was more. Noah had to do more than just believe. Go ahead. Is that it?
No.
Verse 16.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
So now
everlasting life.
So he is our plan of salvation, our way of escape. See, the one that they scoffing at, the Jesus that they kicking on is the plan of salvation. They don't believe that this God in his Bible is going to do what he said he's going to do, and he's giving us the way out, and that way is Jesus. They mock at Jesus. They laugh. It's a joke to them. Probably the same way it was with those people that saw Noah building his ark on dry land. Probably the same way. They probably was out there mocking him, and he had to endure that for almost 100 years while he was building that ark. Imagine that. He's building his ark. It's going to rain, and they mocking him. Every day he's working and working and working because the Lord's going to flood the earth, and he's working, doing his work. And they mock, what you doing, Noah? You building the ark, Noah? You building the ark? Mocking them, but Noah knows that it's going to rain. He knows. We know that the Lord is going to come with fire. We are trying to save ourselves. Let's look at Mark 16.
Verse 17.
Okay, go ahead.
For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Go ahead.
He that believeth on him is not condemned.
He that believeth on him, who is this? Jesus. He said, he that believeth on Jesus. Go ahead.
Is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he have not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
He don't believe in the way out. It's like I talked about the burning building. He didn't believe in that plan in the burning building. He just joked around over there, and then when it actually happened and the building started burning, everybody else that I gave an example of, they ran out the building, but he didn't know what to do. Right. It's the same thing with those people that are mocking and joking around. You know, they don't believe that the Lord said he's going to do what he said he's going to do. Jesus to them is a joke. He's the spook God, but we know better. Let's look at Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. And we're doing exactly what he told us to do. We're trying to warn people, just like Noah tried to warn them. They was looking like, look, you know, you build this ship on this dry ground, Noah, and it ain't going to rain, Noah. But Noah's trying to, hey, it's going to rain. We are trying to warn people too. Mark chapter 16, and pick it up at verse 15. Mark 16 and verse 15. Go ahead.
And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature.
Mm-hmm.
He that believe and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned.
So now he said, go out, preach the gospel, and him that believeth, they're going to be saved. They're going to be saved. But if you don't believe, you are going to be damned. You're going to be damned. You know, you got people, too, that talk about, well, you know, you don't have to be baptized. Jesus was baptized. What's wrong? I want to be like Jesus. I'm going to get baptized, too.
Right.
I'm going to get baptized, too. So he said in verse 15, he said, go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature.
Right.
He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. So is he talking about saving? You ain't got nothing to worry about? It's more than just believing. You got to go out there and show some works with your belief. Faith without works is what? It's dead. So you got to do some works with it. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And that's one thing that they don't tell you, that the Lord will damn you. He give you the plan of salvation. He give you what he told you what to do to save yourself. If you don't want to save yourself, you are going to be damned. You're going to be damned. Let's look at Matthew now. Matthew chapter 19. Like, we're going to finish kind of early again. Matthew chapter 19. And we're going to pick it up at verse 16. Matthew 19 and verse 16. Go ahead, read.
And behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?
That's a good question. How do we save ourselves? You know, he said, what good thing that I may do that I may have eternal life? That's a good question for all of us to ask. Go ahead.
And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
So he said, why calls thou me good? If you want life, keep the commandments. So now we know about the Ten Commandments, but the Lord also commanded about the feast days. And we just had the Passover. The Lord commanded, but one of the Ten Commandments is the fourth commandment. We observe the fourth commandment. We observe them all. But the fourth commandment is remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
That's right.
So now we're here every Sabbath. Now, when you read in Leviticus 23, it talks about the Passover. The Passover represents the Lord passing over our sins, like he had told him to put the blood over the doorpost. The Lord passed over the sins of Israel. He passed them over so the Lord didn't kill all they firstborn. And then we have the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Unleavened bread represents us eating the unleavened word and walking in the truth.
That's
we're
right.
Walking in the truth. When it speaks of the Feast of Pentecost. The Lord's going to return in the 50th year. See, all this is the plan of salvation that the Lord has given us so that we can save ourselves. And it's a memorial for us to remember. So we're keeping the Feast of Pentecost. The Lord's going to return in the 50th year. It also represents the first fruits. How Jesus was the first fruits, and he's the firstborn of the dead, and we are going to be part of that many brethren to follow. So we got the Feast of Pentecost. Then we dealing with the trumpets, how the trumpets are going to sound and announce the return of Jesus. And they're going to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month and the 50th year on the Day of Atonement. See, all this is his plan of salvation. So now when he returns on the Day of Atonement, then he's going to gather Israel. That's what Tabernacles is about.
Right.
It's all his plan of salvation. How he's going to gather Israel, and he's going to take us back to the land. Just like, hold your hand there. Let's look at Acts real quick. And that's when he's going to do this right here. See, the Lord gave us the plan to save ourselves. But you have people that are going around saying they just say a simple prayer and that's it. That's not what it is. Acts chapter 2, this is what the Lord's going to do, this because they asked the Lord the question. Right here in Acts chapter 2 and verse 6. Acts 2 and 6. I'm sorry, Acts 1 and verse 6. Go ahead.
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel?
Go ahead.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the time or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power.
See, he didn't say he wasn't going to do it. See, again, this is all his plan. He's going to restore it during tabernacles. The Lord's going to gather his people. He's going to gather Israel. And he's going to restore us to the land then.
That's right.
And then you have the eighth day of tabernacles. When the Lord is going, when the Father's going to come and all flesh, it ain't going to be no more flesh and blood. Ain't going to be no more flesh and blood. See, these days, that's his plan of salvation. That's his whole plan. And as long as we continue and follow his plan, we can save ourselves. We can save ourselves, but we got to follow the plan. Let's look at John 8, and we got one more after this. John chapter 8. John chapter 8. And we're going to pick and just read that one verse, John 8 and verse 24. This is to those brothers that don't believe that that the Lord's not going to do what he said he's going to do. They don't believe in Jesus. They scoffing at Jesus. John 8 and 24. Go ahead.
I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins.
Uh-huh.
But if ye believe not that I am he.
If you don't believe that Jesus is God, if you don't believe that he's going to do exactly what he said he's going to do, and how he's going to do it, he's going to burn this whole world up. The earth's going to be burned and few men left. If you don't believe that, if you don't follow his plan of salvation that he had put out here, go ahead.
Ye shall die in your sins.
You're going to die in your sins. You're going to die in your sins. Here's our plan of salvation. The Lord gave us the plan to save us, to save ourselves. Acts chapter 2 and verse 40. This is going to be it. Acts 2 and verse 40. Go ahead when you get there.
And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation.
And that's what we're doing. We're exhorting, we're asking people, and we're making sure that everybody that gets a chance hear our voice, hey, save yourself from this untoward generation. This is the plan the Lord gave us to save ourselves. So that's it. The Lord gave us a plan to save ourselves, and I hope you got some understanding in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We finished early, y'all, so I know in L.A. they probably dancing right now, you know. I thought it was going to last a little bit longer than that, but.
Praise the Lord.
We got the announcements for the day is, let's see, we're going to be having a Feast of Pentecost coming up. And we got one baptism on the Feast of Pentecost. We got a baptism on the Feast of Pentecost. With that said, you read the announcements.
Our prayers is that the eyes of your understanding were enlightened by today's lesson. DVDs and CDs of all of our lesson are available. Please place your order in the offering box along with your donation and pick your DVDs, CDs up at the podium next Saturday. Please tune in to Thy Kingdom Come television program, which airs in various locations. Please join us at our study classes, Question and Answer Bible Study, every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time via conference call line at 712-432-1620, access code 609910 pound. Also stream live from our website, thoukingdomcome7.com. Children Bible classes ages 4 through 12 every Sabbath at 12 noon. Teen Form Bible classes ages 13 through 19 every other Sabbath, Saturday at 5 p.m. If you feel you are ready to be baptized, please sign the baptism list at the podium and or speak with Brother Oscar. Following is the dress code for our services. All clothing should be modest in appearance. Nothing tight-fitting, overly baggy, sagging, or revealing should be worn. Men are to remove hats and all head coverings, and women should wear a head covering such as a hat or scarf, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 1 through 7. If your young child becomes noisy during the lesson, distracting other members, please remove him or her to the TV munching area in the rear of the class. And tithes and or free will offerings should be put in an offering envelope and placed in the offering box near the podium. Pray for our strength as we pray for you. Until next Sabbath, peace.
Peace. All right, like I said, y'all, we finished early. I don't know what y'all gonna do at home, so be careful. It's still a Sabbath. Y'all,
LA coming up.
Follow that plan of salvation. All right, with that said, we're gonna stand up, face the roof, we're gonna close out. May the Lord keep y'all this week in Jesus' name.
Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven.
Our Father, which art in heaven.
Hallowed be thy name.
Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the power.
And the glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endures forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endures forever.
For his mercy endures forever.
These things we pray in Jesus' name.
These things we pray in Jesus' name.
The Holy One of Israel.
The Holy One of Israel.
The Mighty One of Jacob.
The Mighty One of Jacob.
The Lord of Lords.
The Lord of Lords.
And there is no other.
And there is no other.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
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 In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.